Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Just before I get started, I just wanted to share something I'd came across on my, it was actually on my Twitter feed a little while ago, and it was a sentiment that for gender equality, it's not about having the next female Steve Jobs or the next female Elon Musk, but it's actually more about having lots and lots of women who are mediocre middle managers. So in the idea is that we just want to get more people into tech. So based on that, I thought, well, to do my bit for gender equality, I'm going to come up and I have to give a mediocre talk. Yeah, just kidding. This is going to be awesome. So I'm Tracy Miranda, and let's talk about diversity. Okay, so one of the things that's been great to see coming into Cloud Foundry and into the community is just this theme of digital transformation that's affecting all the industries, insurance, and even governments. And taking that even further, with when we talk about the Internet of Things, and I work a lot in this area, that is just set to transform all our societies. And yeah, there's no doubt to me that Cloud Foundry is going to be, you know, a big part of that. So these are the driverless pods you have at London Heathrow's airport. So I was at a Smart Cities Summit, and they were talking about how Amsterdam has driverless boats and how Moscow has all their snow removal vehicles are all connected up, so they can manage snow clearance just through an app. So it's clear that Internet of Things is just going to transform everything. It's going to transform how we get to work. It's going to transform how we cut our grass. And it's even going to transform things like how we play with our kids. So the question I have for you is, how do we make sure when we're building this that we're not just solving problems for the elite, for the privileged, or for the rich? And we have some cautionary tales from other industries. In genetics, you've got the Human Genome Project and clinical trials. And there's this really interesting TED talk I came across where they're talking about how, you know, 96% of clinical trials are all done with genes of European descent. And, you know, genetic studies affect health, and different people react to different things based on their genetics. So I find something like that, you know, it's pretty shocking, and it's something that has to be changed. But we're not going to worry about that industry. There are people working on that. But we're going to say, what can we do in our own tech communities? So I've been working in tech for over 10 years now. And it's a bit of a shame to say that in those 10 years, I haven't really seen that much of a change in terms of the makeup of who's building tech. And so the questions we ask are, you know, how can we change perceptions, and how do we gain the critical mass? And Ursula had some really good points in the presentation this morning. So one of the things we've seen is, you know, whatever we've been doing for the last 10 years, it's not really working. But one thing that we know does work is diversity champions. So has anyone here considered themselves a diversity champion for their community? Yeah, great. Excellent. So actually what I'd like for everybody in this room to, from this moment, consider yourself a diversity champion for your community, not just for Cloud Foundry, open source community, but for where you work, where maybe if you're in an institution, or even your virtual communities, you know, you can be the diversity champion for a Slack channel. No, we just need more champions out there. So, you know, that's the one thing I'm going to say. You're all now officially diversity champions, right? And what these seven habits are is really about a framework for how can we sustain diverse tech communities. What's our thinking going to be? And it's not prescriptive. but it's more about just getting into that mindset and keeping in mind that the more diverse our tech communities, then, you know, the more resilient and secure our societies will be. So what are we all going to do together? We'll start with habit one, and you've also got these on your tables, so that I'll go through them one by one. Okay, habit one, be self-aware. So this is about saying who's in our communities, and more importantly, who's not. And another element of this is what privileges enable people to become part of the tech communities to build these things. And we'll come back to this idea of privilege. But one of the things I want to make a point here is that, you know, if we don't have this critical self-examination, we run the danger of having communities that start to have problems. Facebook has a diversity problem. At its Menlo Park headquarters, it's got 5,500 employees, mostly men. Of those, they've got about 81 people who are black, so that's less than 2%. And earlier this year in February, Mark Zuckerberg actually had to call in the whole campus to address them, because it turned out that some people had been graffitiing Black Lives Matter slogans around the campus. So Black Lives Matter is it's the rights movement in the US where, you know, black people are trying to get the justice they should be entitled to. But some employees at Facebook, who perhaps are in a privileged position to not even appreciate the issues, kind of saw that as only Black Lives Matter or Black Lives Matter more. And so they took offense at this. And there was a real lack of empathy there, and just, you know, starting to see the lack of values in the community. So we don't get to that point, which brings us to habit two, which is promoting shared values. So I have two kids in car seats, as I like to say, and, well, I let them out of their car seats sometimes. But they go to this school, and the school has this idea of what they call a values-led education. And I didn't really pay much attention to this until there's one day I was getting ready for, we were all going to go to a friend's wedding, and everything was running slow, and I was eager to get on the road. So I started barking at the kids, you know, hurry up, get your things on, move faster. And then my five-year-old at the time, he turned to me and he goes, "Mommy, you're not showing the value of patience." So that really stopped me in my tracks because, well, A, he was right, but B, I was just taken aback by the language he was using. And it sort of came down to this thing they were doing at their school, where every month they would focus on a value. So this month's is confidence. But it would be things like self-control, empathy, courage. And the really nice thing about it is that they would embed that throughout their curriculum. So they would weave it in a non-preachy way, and the kids would really sort of get on board with that. So they would, you know, one would say to another, you know, don't give up, show the value of determination. Or even better, they would, you know, call out their teachers on it. So, yeah, I like when they call out their teachers much more when they call out me. So it got me thinking, like, can we do more in this in our tech communities? For a long time, tech has been about the tech. And we sort of ignore the people who are doing this and ignore the fact that people come with a lot of baggage and we all have different values coming into it. But this is starting to change. So if you think about it, we already promote the value of respect, and this has been happening more and more communities. Cloud Foundry, you have your code of conduct up there. I've got the Eclipse. We have a community code of conduct in addition. And the idea is to say, put respect front and center and say, this is what we're about. So the other thing I was really happy to see at this conference is just there's a lot of weaving in of empathy. So I've seen that in a few of the keynotes and some of the presentations. But I challenge you to say, well, how can we do more of that? How can we bring in other values, put them up front and center and say, look, this is what we're about, and this is what we're going to, you know, hold each other to and call each other out on, and then just promote that so we do have that sense of just shared values. Okay, habit three, and we're going to pick up the pace here a bit. So learn and grow together. Loads of things are changing. Take, for example, something like gender. Once upon a time, we thought it was just simple, you know, binary thing, but now we're learning more and more, and it's important we do that together. And habit four, be open and inclusive. So openness is about transparency. You know, how transparent are our systems? And inclusivity is about real inclusivity. You know, is there a path for every sort of person to join into our community and be part of it at every level? Okay, so with these two habits, learning and growing together, I thought we could do some learning and growing together right now. And to keep it open and inclusive, I'm going to get some of you involved. Okay, so what we're going to do, going back to this idea of privilege, we're going to play the privilege game. Who likes games? Nobody. Oh, got some. Okay, so what this is there's an idea that a college professor was trying to teach his class about privilege by using a waste paper basket and some crumpled up paper. But we're going to do the tech version of that. So I had these great ideas of how I was going to make, you know, a smart privilege bucket, which is going to have some sensors, some LEDs. It's going to upload things to the cloud. After the presentations yesterday, I was trying to think how I could get Cloud Foundry into that. Not quite there yet. But in the true spirit of Agile, we're going to have our MVP, which I'm going to bring out. And the tech is just a bit of distraction, but I'll tell you what we're going to do. Right, so we've got our bucket, and we've got some balls, and I'm going to get some volunteers. So what we're going to make it interesting, so let's say the simple idea is I'm going to give a few of you some balls, and if you can throw your ball into the bucket, then you would be entitled to something in this community. Let's say you can stay for the rest of the day, perhaps. Right? And if not, maybe we're going to ask you to leave because, well. Okay, so, but the only catch is that in order to get it in, you have to stay where you're seated. Right? So I'm going to give two up there. And do we have any? Let's go a bit further away now, and I'm going to come see you guys over here. Can I get you to take a couple? Three. A couple for you. Yeah. Health and safety, they are going to be projectiles flying around. And I'll give another one here to anyone at the table. Right, and we're going to say that the bucket is going to live over there. And let's see if this is going to cooperate.
So do you lose the privilege if you destroy this?
Okay, so let's just see how everyone's going to do. I'm going to ask the table with the red balls here to go ahead and have a go and see if you can get to stay. Yeah. Two in. You only had to get one in. Oh, yeah, you've got your one in. Ooh, great. Okay, so we're going to just toss this out. And right, now, and everyone, please watch your heads. I'm going to stand way over here. You've been warned, no liability. Okay, so can we get people at the orange table, orange, to throw the balls in and see what we can get? Yeah. Close. No, so close. Okay, the next habit is give everyone a voice. So I'm going to ask the people who've been throwing balls if you could actually come up here, and everyone who got a ball in, if you could stand on that side, and if we could get a few people to stand on there if you didn't get a ball in. So go on. I'm going to get you all. If you got the ball in, stand on this side, and you are our community rock stars. You have achieved something great, and all right. So I'm going to talk to the guys who, you know, have done well in this challenge, and go, well, was that easy for you?
Yes.
Yeah. Well done. And you seem to have a really good technique there. Is that something you've been working on a lot?
No, it was just in the spur of the moment.
Excellent. So you're just a natural talent, is that right? And now I'd like to ask, would you guys consider, would anyone be willing to maybe write a book about your techniques?
Yeah, I could write a book about how not to throw in the bucket from 1 meter away.
Right. Okay, now I'm going to give everyone a voice, and we're going to talk to some of the folks here. Do you want to just come in a bit? Oh, yeah, I guess come over from... So, do you not want to stay at the Cloud Foundry Summit today?
I tried really hard.
Okay, let's talk to someone else. Did you try really hard?
I gave it my best effort.
And do you think you could do something differently next time to succeed?
No.
And these guys over there are going to write a book about how to do it. Would you like to buy their book?
Yes, 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 yes. It will make you feel so much better.
Do you think that will make a difference to you actually getting it in the bucket?
No.
No. So what do you think it's going to take for you to get a ball in the bucket and stay?
A lot of training.
A lot of training. So I think those guys over there are the people to talk to. And you came really, really close. How did that feel?
Still like failure.
So, yeah, I'm going to recommend to all you guys that, well, you know, you talk to these guys because they know how to do it, and get some tips from them, and maybe, you know, maybe buy their book, and maybe better luck next time, okay? Right. And thank you to you guys. You've done really well. All right, everyone give them a round of applause. Okay, so... I think what we're trying to get at here is we call it the privilege bucket because it's clear to everyone in the room that everyone at this table it's way easier for them to get the ball in. But for them, you know, everyone is focused on what's between them and the goal. So they are kind of looking at the bucket and they're saying, well, I'm going to get it in and I'm going to do my best. But the people who just have more obstacles between them, and the bucket could represent a job, it could represent funding, it could represent a promotion. For them, there might be things that are preventing them from, even though they might be even better throwers than the people here, you know, it's just, they're not going to get the ball in unless we address that. So in terms of giving everyone a voice, sometimes this means speaking up. Sometimes it means just shutting up and letting other people talk, and also advocating for others. If you're in a position of authority or a position where people listen to you, you know, advocate for others. If you're the ones close to the bucket and you can see things aren't so fair, you may advocate for the people who are further away. Say, look, we need to change the system. We need to move the bucket. We need a bigger bucket. You know, just... everyone needs to have a voice and find a way for them to be heard. Okay, habit 6, acknowledge biases. We've seen a lot of this at the keynotes. Daniel talked about the present bias, and Ursula talked about unconscious bias. And we've had bucket bias as well. And one of the ones I like to bring up is something called fundamental attribution error. And it's a term psychologists use. The experiment goes that they'll take two groups of basketball players who are equally good, and they'll get them shooting hoops. One set will be in a very well-lit gym, and one set will be in a very poorly lit gym. So the ones in the poorly lit gym will just miss more often. And they asked people to rate which group of basketball players they thought was better. And people will go, well, the first group. But people aren't very good, and we have a bit of a blind spot about environment. So it's hard for people to go and say, oh, well, actually, I can tell that it's darker in that room, so they're just as good as that group, but we need to fix the environment. And I feel like that in tech a lot, that people will come and they'll look at it and say, oh, well, you know, maybe it's only men doing it, so therefore the women must not be good at it, rather than saying, well, actually, we need to fix the environment. So it's just a blind spot to be aware of, that we have to look more carefully at the environments and underlying causes of things. And if we do that, then it's probably obvious to us where we can fix it. So that comes to the point of investing and investing in equality. For this, I'm not going to tell you how to do it, but I'm going to give you some analogy from the world of cycling. And sometimes, you know, if you're cycling in the city, it can be really dangerous, and dealing with roundabouts is one of the worst things you can do. And sometimes cities will deal with it by saying, oh, well, you know, this is our level of investment. We're going to put a sign up, and we're going to say, onus is on you now to be careful. But, you know, that doesn't work for everyone. It doesn't work for visually impaired people. You're not likely to want to go cycling there with a child. So instead of doing that sort of investment, we need to talk about real investment. Anyone here from Amsterdam? Yeah. So this is Amsterdam's answer to cycling across roundabouts, and that's a suspended bike circle. So anyone can get across the roundabout there. You can, you know, in Amsterdam, lots of different people cycle. Parents are more likely to cycle with their kids. And the whole idea is that, you know, they're investing in infrastructure for everyone. And that's what we want to be doing in tech as well. And we know it costs money, but we know it's really, really worthwhile. So I'll leave you with that. And these are our 7 habits. And in your new role as diversity champions, I hope it's something you can take and share with your communities and just come up with ways of how we can do this together. So with that, we've come to the end, and I'll leave you to discuss your topics, and I look forward to hearing some feedback and just some ideas we can all share and learn together. So thank you very much.